So let's start. Before I start, I wanted to give you the coordinates to the web page where you can find the lecture notes and also some background material. And if you want to access the notes, you need to use this password here. It's to teach you some German. It's Mont Blanc in German, so Weißer Berg and 2018. And what you can find there is the lecture notes. So it's not working here. The lecture notes. Then also what I put up there is supplementary material for the lecture. That means I've given some lecture on non-aerodynamics, explaining very basic things about phase space, fixed points, and so on. That's mainly material which you can also find in the really nice book by Strogatz. And for your convenience, I put this together so you can read the details of non-aerodynamics there. And what you can also find is some review articles and some original articles. All right, so I will be on the board mainly today, but I would like to start just reminding you of the basic question we were trying to ask, and this is really the main theme of today's lecture. Namely, how do proteins self-organize into patterns? That's the question I want to answer. And you saw this. This is a movie of a yeast cell which shows a particular polar pattern. And I will not use that system because it's way too complicated. The biochemistry is complicated. The geometry is complicated. So I will reduce the system to be as simple as possible, but not too simple to still capture the main features of a pattern-forming system. So what I will do is I'll go to a single protein species, so just one protein, and this one protein has two states, so two conformations. One state is that it's bound to the surface of the yeast cell, so it's bound to the membrane. And the other state, it is freely diffusing in the cytosol, so in the bulk, in the interior of that sphere. And I could do that in spherical coordinates. Would be fun, I guess. That gives opportunity to work with complete functions, but I won't do this because that's just geometrically complicating things. So I'll go to a one-dimensional model, where in this one-dimensional model, there is no explicit membrane and there's no explicit cytosol. They're both in this one-dimensional lattice. And the way you should think of this is in terms of compartments, reactors, fluid elements, if you like. So a set of individual containers in which you have reactions and between which you have diffusion, exchange, hopping, as you like. So there's then a total protein mass, which is N. That is the mass in the density on the membrane plus the density in the cytosol. And this overall mass is conserved. That's the basic assumption of the analysis. And in order to account for the different physical properties of membrane and cytosol, I'll take the diffusion constants to be different. Not necessarily the diffusion constant on the membrane being much smaller than the diffusion constant in the cytosol, but that's the typical case. So you should assume something like, as I said, 0.01 micrometer squared per second for diffusion on the membrane and 10 micrometer squared per second for diffusion in the cytosol. So that's the setup in terms of geometry, in terms of variables. And then you can write down equations, diffusion reaction equations, describing exactly that. So you have an equation for the membrane density, you have an equation for the cytosolic density, there is a diffusion term with the different diffusion constants, and there's a reaction term. In general, you would think that you should have a reaction term for the reactions on the membrane, and you should have a reaction term for the reactions in the cytosol. So two functions, F and G, which are completely general and arbitrary at this point. This is not an equation I invented. This is an equation which goes back to Alan Turing in his really seminal paper in 1952, where he really made a very important contribution to the field, namely showing that if you combine diffusion and combine with reaction, you can have pattern formation. Now, that was very, very, very deep insight. And I'll start from there. So from now on, let me go to the board and continue there. So here we go. So what we start with is the following. A two-component model in one dimension, and you saw the equations. So there's an equation for the membrane, there's an equation for the cytosol, there's a diffusion term on the membrane, there is a diffusion term also in the cytosol, and the square. So then you add the reactions, and now there's a subtlety, or an important feature actually. Should I write G in general, or should I write something else? Remember, I want that I have dTn integrated over the whole system to be zero, right? Because I want to have particle number, protein mass conservation. And now let's say you have boundary conditions such that at the left and right boundary there is a no flux condition, so particles can either leave the right or left of the system. And then as you integrate this here with those boundary conditions, the diffusion terms drop out and you're left with just the reaction terms. So for that to be true, the only option you really have is to write here a minus F of M and C. Right? This sounds like a trivial modification of Turing's original equations, but as you will see, this is a quite important mathematical feature which leads to a range of very important physical phenomena in those pattern-forming systems. I'm also not the first to write that equation down. That equation here is discussed at length in the literature of cell polarization models, mainly in terms of specific models applied to particular biological problems. What I want to do is I want to guide you through that equation and explain to you what the features are that come out from the analysis of that equation. All right, and what I will do is I will actually try to explain everything in the following space, the space of C and M, where there is no explicit space. So I project everything back on what's called the phase space. Oops, the phase space of the system. And in that phase space, if you look at an equation where you blend out those diffusion terms here, then you'll have mass conservation in the sense that the system is now spatially homogeneous, and you have a homogeneous mass even in the system, such that in that case, the system will actually lie on a simplex, which is given by n bar equals m plus c, and n bar is simply defined as the average mass that you have in your system, right? So to make you a little bit familiar with the possible reaction terms in the system, let me specify this m, this function f a bit, so you see what this could mean. So let's take an example. So F of M and C is supposed to describe reactions where you have interaction of proteins such that they attach to the membrane and they detach from the membrane back into the cytosol. And typically, you can have a structure like so. You have a term which describes the attachment. So you have an attachment term saying that if there is some cytosolic concentration, then depending on what you have on the membrane, there will be attachment. So for example, this function A of M could be just a simple attachment term, so a kinetic rate K on times C, or it could be a feedback term where you have a kinetic rate K for feedback times M to the alpha, and for alpha I can take various values. If you remember from yesterday, there I took alpha equal to 1 and called this a contact process. Here, in general, I'll need some higher order nonlinearity to get some non-trivial behavior, and the example I take is alpha equal to 2. You can look at other terms. So for example, you could also add here something which implies that the on kinetics is not arbitrarily growing as you have more and more membrane proteins, but there's some saturation such that you have here a denominator going like 1 over m squared. Okay, so you see there's attachment, there's feedback, and then here you can also have a detachment term, and this detachment term can again have various forms, and for simplicity, the term I take is simply dm is just a kinetic rate k off times m. So with a probability per unit time, you detach if you are bound to the membrane. All right, so now let's analyze this equation piece by piece. And the best way to start is actually to blend out the diffusion term first and just simply look at the reaction kinetics alone. So that I call a well-mixed system. You may also think of this as just one of those yellow reactors I showed in the beginning. So a small system where diffusion is so fast that mixing happens on a much, much faster time scale than chemical reactions. Okay, so for that well-mixed system, let me write down the equations. They are much simpler now. And now let's ask, what are the equilibria? So what are those concentrations, M and C, such that you have that the temporal derivatives of M and C vanish? So that implies you must have F of MC, M star and C star equal to 0. Those are the equilibria. All right. And they're determined by an implicit equation, F equals to 0. And this equation, F equal to 0, is actually called the null Klein of a nonlinear problem. And let me draw that null Klein here in this particular space. So let's say F equal to 0 for this type of function will typically look like so, or alternatively, this can also look like so. And as we will learn during the lecture, those two cases are distinct in terms of what the stability of these various fixed points are, because the equilibria are not just determined by that relation that gives you a set of equilibria. You also need to have that M star plus C star equals to n, so that you are on these simplices here on the left or on the right. So let me call this here null Klein, and this here a reactive phase space, because the phase space for the reactions is confined to that simplex because of mass conservation. All right. Now let's ask about stability here of those fixed points. So let me draw them in. This here is a equilibrium or fixed point. This here is an equilibrium or fixed point, and this and that here as well. And I keep open symbols because I want to at some point fill some of the open symbols to indicate that they are stable fixed points. If they remain open, they're supposed to mean unstable fixed points. So let's look at the stability of the fixed points or equilibria. I will use this interchangeably, so I will talk about fixed points as synonymous for equilibria. So let's look at the stability of these equilibria. Well, and for that end, I'm looking just at the equation of the membrane concentration. So this is dTm equals f of m. And now I'm using the fact that I'm on one of those simplices. That means the concentration in the cytosol is not arbitrary. It needs to be n minus m just from that relation. So n minus m because of mass conservation. And now you just take a Taylor expansion. The leading order term is zero at m star c star. And then I just have the other terms, which is then a temporal derivative, fm. So fm is the derivative of the function f of m. And c evaluated at m star c star times the deviation, so delta m, and delta m is m minus the equilibrium point. And similarly, I do have then here plus fc, but now since I'm having here as an argument n minus m, I can also write this as a minus fc times delta n. Okay, so in total, and this fc is just defined in the same way as the fm. So in total, what I have is that my temporal change of m, and here of course also of delta m, is a eigenvalue sigma local, which will depend on the mass, because those expressions here, those partial derivatives, they are the slopes of this function at the intersection point with the reactive phase space. So it will depend on the local mass times delta m, and I have stability if sigma local is less than zero. So in other words, if minus fm, fm minus fc is less than zero, that's the same expression because that's the expression for the local eigenvalue. And now for specificity, let me take a particular choice of signs. So I will assume that fc is greater than zero. You can also discuss, if you like, the other case, fc smaller than zero. Doesn't really change what the outcome is qualitatively. And here, if you look at this particular example of that reaction function, the derivative fc is just a of m, and that will always be greater than zero because a of m is a constant and times something which is just positive. All right, so in that case, the condition actually reads, and let me write it this way, minus fm over fc is greater than minus 1. All right. And that at first sight just looks at a mathematical condition. What I want, and that's important for me to teach to you, is that you can have a geometric interpretation of this condition. So what's that geometric interpretation? Well, look at this relation. So if I take the Nalkline and I write this Nalkline as a function of m, so f of m, c star of m, this here is c star of m, this is equal to zero, and then you can just take the derivative of that expression, and by taking the derivative of that equation, you find that dc star of m equals minus fm over fc. So that means this expression which you have here is nothing but the slope of the Nalkline. Okay? So the slope of the Nalkline determines the condition under which the fixed points are stable. And now let me go to these graphs here and check where you have stability and where you have instability. So, well, you can help me with this. Unstable? Yeah. Unstable in the center. That's right. So the condition is, if the slope of this reactive phase space is steeper, is less steep than the slope of the Nalkline, that's a geometric condition, then you have an unstable fixed point, or unstable equilibrium. And all the other cases where you see that the slope of the Nalkline is actually less steep than the slope of this reactive phase space, you have a stable fixed point. So here we go. These are stable equilibria, and this one is a unstable equilibrium. So from that you can already tell that the geometric shape of the Nalkline determines in a very straightforward way whether your system will be monostable as you tune the mass, meaning here the simplex, you move it up or down. In this case, you will always find just one stable equilibrium. And here, as you tune the mass, so the position of the simplex up and down, you find monostability here. There's a bistable region in between. And as you further increase the total mass, you get monostability again. So here you have a bistable window, and this here is a monostable system. Now, let me also introduce two concepts which are termed a concept which is called control parameter. So what's a control parameter here in that case? Meaning a parameter that changes the outcome of whether I have equilibria or whether they're stable and unstable. Well, if you look here, let's take this particular example. There are obvious control parameters which are just the kinetic rates. So the on rate, the off rate, the feedback rate. Those are control parameters. And what they do is they change the shape of the Nalkline. And you can imagine by changing those parameters that you can make the shape go from here to there. And indeed you can. And the parameter you change is essentially this kaon. So these are control parameters. And these are all these chemical rates that are in the reaction terms. There's one more. Yeah, go ahead. What's your question? What is zero? This one? This just is the definition of the null cline. The null cline is defined as the set of points in phase space where the reactions cease, where you have an equilibrium. So F0 means DTM is 0 and DTC is 0. All right? Other questions? Yeah? So what's not plotted here in this graph here is the function f, right? It's just plotting the null cline. Yeah, you can certainly find a condition which defines when fc is positive, right? This is not a major thing. Don't let us get hooked up at this point. This is just one choice I make. This is not important. All right. Now, what I shouldn't forget to say, and this is important, is that another control parameter is the overall protein mass, right? This is key, that as you change the protein mass, you change the behavior of the system, and the way you change that now is that you have these reactive phase spaces, and changing n is changing those reactive phase spaces up and down. And via that, you can create bifurcations, you create different behavior of the system. And let me just illustrate that for a particular example. So let me take that example. So let's focus on this example here. And work out, just as an exercise to see how this goes, what is the phase diagram or stability diagram as a function of the control parameters. Now what you can do in these type of equations is that you don't dimensionalize your system. So that means you use the fact that you can choose the time scale and you use the fact that you can choose a scale for the concentration, right? So what I do is I choose my time scale such that k off is identical to 1, and I choose the scale of the concentration variables by making this feedback constant equal 1, and then you remain with a single control parameter, which I then simply call k. Right, so there's one control parameter k in this non-dimensionalized form and another control parameter which is n bar. So that means your stability diagram can be plotted as a function of n bar and k. Well, so what is that stability diagram? And for those who are not so familiar with non-dynamics, this is the same as talking about a phase diagram, but here it really means that you're talking about stability. And stability just means really in this context here whether I have a regime which is bistable or whether I have a regime that is monostable. So all right, let's try and find this out. And for simplicity, let's look at the case where k is identical to 0. So let's say k is 0. In that case, my function f of m and c is just simply m squared c minus m. And then the phase space plot is very simple. So here I have c again, and here I have m again. This is, say, my reactive phase space. And now the null clients that you have, so those where I put this equal to 0, you can read this off quite simply. This is m equal to 0. So that's one case. And the other one is that m equals to 1 over c, or c is equal to 1 over m, right? Now, you can easily see now when you have monostability and bistability, as long as the simplex is here below this hyperbola, you just have one intersection point, which is this one here. So you are in the monostable regime. And as soon as you touch the hyperbola here, you will get a bistable regime. Well, when does that happen? This point here is at 1, 1, right? So it will happen if n equals 1 plus 1 is 2. All right, so this is then the lower bound here for 2 and up. As you go to infinity, the system will be bistable, and it will be monostable below. All right, if you then continue and want to know what's happening for large values of k, an interesting point is just the following. So for k finite, for k greater than 0, if you take the condition, namely this one, that you have the slope being identical to minus 1 as the bistability condition, what you will find is that this gives you a condition on the corresponding membrane concentration values, which reads as follows. So 1 minus 2k plus or minus square root of 1 minus 8k. You can figure this out quite simply. This is just solving quadratic equations. And from that you read off, if k is larger than 1/8, you will not have two different values here, though the system must be monostable. Okay, so we have a threshold value of k equal 1/8, where the system is monostable. Well, and the rest is a bit tricky to figure out, and I leave this for you as a exercise. So the phase diagram or stability diagram then looks like so. This goes down, and then here this ends up in this point in a cusp-like singularity. Okay, and those cusp-like singularities, so those points here, they are special points in a phase diagram or stability diagram of a bistable system, because at those particular points you have special type of symmetries. So here, the kind of bifurcations you get are as follows. So let me go through. So here you have monostable. As you move up, you will get here two fixed points, one stable and one unstable one. That's called a saddle node bifurcation. And that's the typical case along this boundary and along that boundary. Okay, so here you will have saddle node. So meaning you get an unstable and a stable fixed point. And here, if you go along a particular direction, you get a special bifurcation, which is called a pitchfork bifurcation. But I'll leave you to figure this out. And remember, those points are special. They require special symmetry, and only then you get a particular type of bifurcations. The typical bifurcation is a saddle node one, where you have the emergence of an unstable and stable fixed point at a threshold value of a control parameter. All right. So that's the story as far as the well-mixed system concerns. Yeah, please ask a question. That's how you should see it. So today we have this example. You mentioned it. If you add in a magnetic field, then what you have is that you no longer have a square root behavior of the magnetization, but it's getting smooth. That's the behavior of one of those two fixed points. And the saddle node is actually happening when you look further down, lower at lower temperatures, where then you have an unstable and a stable fixed point emerging, corresponding to the wrong sign, so to say, of the magnetization. All right. So this is first order is the typical scenario, and second order is a special point. You can call this also a critical point, and very much the same meaning as in the theory of phase transitions. So I have not talked about space, and there's no diverging length scale yet. All right, so that's how far you can go with an analysis of the well-mixed system. And now let me turn to the spatially extended system. Spatially extended system, there you now have to ask yourself whether a spatially homogeneous profile is actually stable. Right? So is that solution here, which I found stable, when I add back on diffusion? Okay. So stability of the spatial uniform solution. To diffusive coupling. And that means now both dm and dc are positive. Well, how would you figure this out? There's a standard way of figuring this out, namely, you use the equations, which are no longer on the board, but you have them in your notes. You use these diffusion reaction equations. You look at the system in a finite boundary with the corresponding boundary conditions. You do a Fourier analysis of that equation, and then you ask whether the Fourier modes you get have eigenvalues that are positive or negative. If they're positive, then those fluctuations grow. And if they are negative, those fluctuations decay. That's the standard way of getting it. All right, but what you only get then is those cases where the system is unstable to small perturbation. You're asking what happens to linear perturbations to the homogeneous state. I want to go a step beyond that, so I will do the following. I will ask myself, what are the conditions for the patterns, right? And then see what range of patterns I get and what the conditions are for that. And then later ask, how do I get there? And you could get there by a small perturbation, or you could get there by an excitation, right? You push the system hard enough by, say, some active transport process to get it over a barrier, and then you could also create a pattern. So let's look at the pattern itself. So the final stationary pattern. Well, what determines that final stationary pattern is simply you take the equations you have in your notes and you put the left-hand side to zero. So the left-hand side to zero says zero is dm dx squared m plus f of mc, and 0 is dc, dx squared c minus f of mc. Those are the stationarity conditions. And you can also write one for the total density, so you add up m and c, so those two equations. Then you get 0 for the sum here equals dm dx squared m minus, plus dc dx squared c. All right? So that means a stationary pattern must be such that in the end I have the curvature of the pattern on the membrane times the diffusion constant equal to the minus the curvature in the cytosol times the diffusion constant. What does it mean physically? This means a change in the gradient, so a change in diffusive fluxes, and this is also a change in diffusive fluxes. In our case, we have a boundary condition, right? The boundary condition reads that dx m at 0 and L equals 0 equals dxc at 0 and L. And as you have that, you can integrate that once, and the boundary terms fall off. So what you remain with is actually this. So the condition for a pattern to exist is that the diffusive flux, a diffusive gradient on the membrane equals the diffusive gradient in the cytosol. So you must have a balance of diffusive fluxes. That's a very important condition, as you will see in a second, because you can use it to actually put the pattern into the phase space. Well, how do we do this? Well, let's just integrate this once more, and then you get an integration constant. So if you integrate this once more, you have dm, and let's divide through dc already, m of x plus c of x equals a integration constant, and let's call this integration constant simply eta 0. All right, and I call that space here the flux balance space. Or flux balance subspace. And let me draw that flux balance subspace now into this phase space diagram. Well, what it simply is, C as a function of m is a straight line, and the straight line has a slope of minus the m over dc. So here we go. This is the flux balance subspace with a slope minus dm over dc. And any pattern you might have or not have, and whether that's an allowed construction I have here or not, must lie in this flux balance subspace. All right? So now what does that mean? Well, the first and most important conclusion you have to make from this is that in your stationary state, the local, the mass here, this n of x, where is it? So n of x in the stationary state is no longer a constant. That's not possible, because in general, dm is not equal to dc, so the slope here is not equal to 1. And that means this flux balance subspace must cut with a whole set of these reactive phase spaces. So necessarily, you conclude that in the steady state, you have a non-uniform distribution of total mass. Or in other words, if you just look at that, for example, so in that particular case, a pattern must lie on this flux balance subspace. That means for let's say, a point like here, the corresponding equilibrium point is over there. And as I go through the flux balance subspace, each point along the line from 0 to L has its own individual equilibrium point. And let me note this down. So you will have a pattern, and let me call those stationary patterns all tilde. All right. Then there's a relation between the pattern and the fixed point values M star NN and C star of N via the fact that you have a redistributed mass in the system. So if you think of this in terms of these compartments, that's really a nice way of visualizing what's going on here. In each of those compartments, at a particular position x, you will have a certain mass, protein mass. This implies that you have a certain fixed point value, mx star cx star, and this particular value is guiding the reactive flow in this local compartment. The system wants to flow from m tilde c tilde towards this point if that's a stable fixed point. So that's one force, quote-unquote, in the system. You try to be, you are pulled towards a fixed point. And at the same time, as you pull towards a fixed point, you're creating gradients in the patterns. And that means you have diffusive fluxes. So you will have this antagonism between reactive turnover trying to pull you towards the local equilibria and diffusive fluxes pushing you elsewhere. In the end, you have an equilibrium state that is determined by this balance between the diffusive fluxes and the balance between the diffusive fluxes and the reactive turnover in the system. All right, because one thing which I didn't tell you yet is namely how you actually get the intercept of this line here. I just gave you the slope. The intercept of this line is actually determined by the fact that if you integrate this function, these relations here over the whole volume, you must get zero, right? So as you integrate from 0 to L over dx f of m and c, this must be zero, and that determines the intercept eta zero in the system. It's another way of saying there's no particles coming in and out. Total reactions produce particles as many as they destroy, meaning makes the conformational changes in one or the other direction. All right. Now, let's go to real space. Up to now, I've been staying in phase space, and now I want to show you how you connect this phase space picture with real space, how you actually construct now the pattern. So let me leave this here. So let's map that now to real space, and for that, let's take a special case, and later on generalize. So C of M here, and let's look at the case where this looks something like that. So you have an N-shaped knock line, and I draw here the flux balance subspace. So that's the flux balance subspace, and this here is the knock line. And now we would like to construct a pattern from that. So I would link this phase space picture to real space. And I'll take as the real space picture the membrane concentration as a function of x between 0 and the total system length. All right. Now, what can I get? I could get something which has many mountains and valleys going up and back and up and down. It turns out that the stationary pattern, and that's something I just want you to take for granted, has to be monotonous, increasing or decreasing, right? And then I can construct it based on that. So I have a value which is m at the left boundary, and I will have a value m tilde at the right boundary, and for specificity, I took the left value lower than the right value. Now what I do know is that I have these no-flux boundary conditions. So that means when I start from here or there, I must start with a slope identical to zero. So that means this should look something like this, and then this something like that, where this upturns and the other one downturns. So there must be an inflection point, right? Obviously. In between. So at this inflection point, what's the characteristic feature? Well, the second derivative of the membrane concentration is zero. That's the inflection point x0, and dx squared of m at the inflection point is zero. And then you can read off from the equations for the stationary distribution that's in your notes, that this implies that f is zero. So there's no reactions at this point. So f at x naught is zero, meaning f in phase space has to be zero. So this point here is identical to that point there. Okay. And I call this a landmark point. So a landmark point in the phase space is an intersection point between the knock line and this flux space, flux balance subspace. And it's identical to the inflection point in the pattern. Now, what about those two points? This one here and that one. What do they correspond in a pattern? Nothing yet, right? What I would need for those two points also have a meaning here in this graph is I take an infinite system. If I have an infinite system, then having a slope identical to zero will imply also that the second derivative is equal to zero at infinity. So as L goes to infinity, these regions here become plateaus, and this one as well, and those points here and this one as well, they are then equivalent to the plateaus in the pattern. So now you see you have a complete representation of the pattern in terms of the phase space, and it's all in terms of geometry, saying that for the pattern to to exist here in the system, in an infinite size system, you have plateaus connected by an interface, and those are determined by the intersection points between the Nalk line and the flux balance subspace. So let me at the end also give an intuition about this value of eta naught. This is this value which determines whether this flux balance subspace goes up and down. And now intuitively, if you look at that, you can tell me, well, I've seen that. Constructions like that, there's some area here, there's some area there. Maybe there's some Maxwell condition. And indeed, in a way, there is. And I show you in what way. It's an approximate way, but it's useful to think about this intuitively like so. So we have this condition, which I already wrote down, that you have the total turnover in the system to be zero. So F of M and C is to be zero. And now let me go and change coordinates. I define a new function F tilde of M and eta such that I take one of my variables to be orthogonal to the set defined by the flux balance subspace. So this is then eta minus m dm dc. So instead of taking the z-axis as my axis, I take the axis orthogonal to the flux balance subspace. And as you take that, and if you just multiply the diffusion reaction equations by m and then integrate, you get as a condition, which is equivalent to this one, that as you integrate from the left-hand side from the pattern to the right-hand side of the pattern, and you integrate this function f tilde of m and eta zero, that this is to be zero. And that teaches you, if you look at it, that the condition for the intercept eta zero doesn't really depend on the full shape of m of x. It only depends on the boundary values m tilde of zero and m tilde of l. And if in addition you go to the limit of l going to infinity, those two boundary values are again just determined geometrically, namely as the intersection points with the Nalk line. And now let's take an approximation so you see what this maybe means. So let's say that f of m and c is approximately the linear relation. So the eigenvalue I calculated from a analysis in the well-mixed case, m of x minus m star. Okay, so instead of taking the full reaction, I just say I'm somehow close enough to the Nalk line such that I can replace the actual flux by the linearized flux. And then let me, in addition, assume that that's constant. And then you see immediately what this implies. If I insert that with sigma being a constant into that relation, what I'll get is m tilde of zero to m tilde l integrated m minus m star of n of m, sorry, of n, yeah, being zero. So this means just what I said, namely a Maxwell condition, that the area I have here equals the area I have right there. All right. So in summary, let me now go back to the slides. This one. So here, this is the key summary of what I just told you. This is a horrible resolution. There is, on the left-hand side, the pattern space, the real space. On the right-hand side, you have the face space. And there's a one-to-one relation between the two. You can read off the pattern from landmark points in the face space. What are the structures? Well, in face space, the important structures are first the null line, so the set of chemical equilibria. Second, the flux balance subspace. And third, all these different local phase spaces, which are indicated in green. The physics of pattern formation here is that in the end, you have flux balance of diffusive fluxes in the cytosol and on the membrane that pins you to the flux balance subspace. And then there is this reactive turnover balance, and that says that the system is pulled here from the flux balance subspace towards the actual local equilibria here and there, and this pull to the left and right of the interface has to balance out, and as it balances out, this determines then the pattern. There's some details left still, because from that I didn't tell you yet what the special features of all these profiles, for example, is. For example, I did not tell you yet where this position x naught is in real space. Is it close to zero? Is it close to L? So it shifts back and forth. And you can already guess what determines that. That's the total mass in the system, right? If you have more mass, you can accommodate for more mass by moving this here to the left or to the right. And what I also didn't tell you yet is what determines the scale here. What's the scale of the interface? How large is that? What is the characteristic length scale that emerges here in the system, and what determines it? What feature of the system is responsible for that? And that's what I'm going to do next. Let me try again here. That's better now. All right. So now to gear you towards that, let me show you a simulation for this example function I showed you. So this function f is an on rate, and then you have a feedback which is saturating because you have m squared over 1 plus m squared, and then you have detachment minus m. And the way the simulation now goes is that I make this correspondence between real space and phase space. On the right-hand side, you see the phase space with its characteristic geometric objects, the null line here and the reactive phase space for the initial system. And initially, the system is homogeneous. You see this from the cytosolic concentration here and there. You roughly add some constant value, and that's indicated by the blue line. And these blue dots here, you see on the right-hand side, they correspond to the values of the concentrations within these set of compartments. So I've discretized my space in some way, and as the system evolves, you will see those dots moving around in phase space. So what's shown as well are these black dots. The black dots are the equilibrium points. So to each blue dot, there corresponds a compartment. The compartment has a certain overall protein mass, and this overall protein mass defines a certain value of the chemical equilibrium in this local compartment. All right. So as I start the movie, you will see the equilibrium move, and you will see the concentrations move, and you will see things move in phase space. All right, let's start. Okay, so what do you see? There was some initial instability. The initial instability had a characteristic scale, a characteristic wavelength. that is a Turing instability. That's what happened here initially. And this characteristic scale, as we'll show you next, comes from a band of unstable modes with a maximum, so there's a largest eigenvalue for this band of unstable modes, and that determined the initial periodic pattern with an intrinsic length scale. Well, what did you see next? Next you saw that these characteristic humps going up and down, they coarsen. And they coarsen such that in the end, you're left with a single polar pattern with a low density on the left and the right density, a high density on the right, lying exactly on this flux balance subspace. Okay, so there's three things here simply. You start initially with a homogeneous pattern, there's a Turing instability, then there's coarsening, and then there's a final pattern. And this should remind you of phase separation kinetics, right? This is the same kind of phenomenology as you see there. The physics is, of course, a little different here, but it's the same type of phenomena. You have an initial instability, a band of unstable modes. This band of unstable modes drives a pattern. The pattern is not stable because there's coarsening, and in the end, you have a polar profile. What's special about the polar profile is something very simple and trivial, that it adapts to the system size. And biologically, that's not a bad feature, because it means whatever the size of your cell is, the system will find a polar pattern that adapts to whatever the size of the cell may be. All right, and another feature which maybe you should also look at once more here is that these equilibria, they are very useful items here in the whole dynamics, because they are like scaffolds. So they scaffold the pattern, and the pattern is pretty close to those equilibria. It's not exactly at the equilibria, but it's drawn towards the equilibria. And as you see, they guide the whole process of coarsening and pattern formation. Well, what does that mean? If the equilibria guide the pattern, and as the equilibria are determined by the mass, the local mass in the system, the local mass must be the most important variable that guides pattern formation in that system. Okay, and that's what I will discuss with you next. So how does the system become unstable, and what is the main underlying physics in the whole process? All right. Okay, so with that insight that the total mass is the important quantity, let's write down an equation for that total mass. So dt n of x and t, and now look in your notes, there's an equation for m, there's an equation for c. You add them up, and as you add them up, the reaction terms, they cancel out, because there's f and minus f, so all that remains is dm dx squared c of x and t, m of x and t plus dc dx squared c of x and t. Okay, now let's look at this equation and read what it means. There's dynamics in the mass, and the dynamics in the mass is driven by what? By changes in diffusive gradients. So let's look at a compartment. One of those I've been talking about at a special spatial position x. And let's look at those terms. There will be a diffusive flux in the cytosol coming into that compartment, and there will be a diffusive flux going out of that compartment. And that's this term. The change in diffusive flux through the compartment is this. There's also a flux on the membrane, and let me draw it the other way around, because I already know that in the end, in equilibrium, there will be a balance of diffusive fluxes on the membrane in the cytosol, giving the equilibrium. And again, the interpretation of that is the change in the diffusive gradients on the membrane, they determine what's going in and out of the system. So here you have the cytosolic flow, and here we have the membrane flow. Okay. Now pictorially, you have this imbalance of those fluxes. So the imbalance of the diffusive fluxes characterized by these gradients. What they do is they drive the dynamics of N. So they drive the redistribution of mass. All right? Now what happens as you redistribute the mass? You change the equilibria, since the equilibria are one-to-one connected with the corresponding value of the mass. So by changing the mass, you will also shift or change the local equilibria m star x and c star x as, yeah, because they are functions of the corresponding local masses. Now, as you change the equilibria, and think of them as scaffolds, so like somebody playing a marionette, you pull these strings up and down, and as you pull these strings up and down, the membrane concentration and the cytosolic concentration will try to flow towards those equilibria. Okay, so there is a reactive dynamics driven by the chemical reactions, which affects the membrane concentration and the cytosolic concentration. And now you've closed the circle. As you change those concentrations here, you are changing the imbalance of the diffusive fluxes, and this is the whole process driving the dynamics. So let me say it again. You have imbalance in the diffusive fluxes. That leads to mass redistribution. The mass redistribution changes the chemical equilibria. The chemical equilibria are scaffolds for the densities. The densities change, the mass changes, and this goes as long as the diffusive flux balance is not reached. Once it's reached, game is over. All right. Now, you can actually analyze this. Where do I have this? Mathematically, in the following way. So we have this here, this set of equations. And now I'm talking all along that the local equilibria are so important. So why not replace M and C by M star and C star? Right, let's do that. So let's replace M and C by M star and C star. But then I have achieved something nice. M star and C star are functions of N, so I have a closed set of equations. So let me write this. M star is a function of N of x and t, and C star is a function of N of x and t. And now I can use that in order to find a closed equation for the mass of the proteins alone. That's not hard, as you will see. Just requires some very basic math. So I'm replacing this by dm dx squared m of n of x and t star plus dc dx squared c of n of x and t star. Well, now you just, and let me call this a name. It's called, in our terminology, adiabatic scaffolding, meaning that I instantaneously follow the scaffold which is given by the chemical equilibria without any kind of delay and without any kind of deviation. So in if so for the scheme I just showed you, that's why I did this first. There's no time scale separation needed whatsoever. This approximation is not controlled. You will see in a minute that there's a limit where it's controlled. So you have to distinguish. I get this question often. So there's one point, the scaffolding, which is this link between dx squared m changes n changes m star pulls m changes n. So this cycle, this is true independent of time scale separation. And that's the physics. The physics is that you have this, the mass redistribution and the scaffolding by the equilibria. This particular equation is a crutch. A crutch to make obvious what happens here, right? It's not exact. It is in a certain asymptotic limit exact, which requires a time scale separation. Okay? But keep it separate. The scaffolding idea or framework is independent of this crutch here. This is a tool I use in order to visualize the most vivid way of what's going on here. So that's scaffolding, and I call this adiabatic because, as you say, it requires a time scale separation, and you'll see in a minute it actually is exact as far as the condition is concerned for the instability. All right, so let me stay with that here, and then, well, write this out. This is an implicit, so m star is a function of n, so I can just use this chain rule. So this is dc dn c star plus dm dn m star dx n squared. So you get a diffusion term. This diffusion term has an effective diffusion constant. This effective diffusion constant depends on the values of the diffusion constants, and it also depends on how the equilibria shift with changing the mass. And let's take the limit where dm is really small, which is usually the case. So that's a small value compared to dc. Then the effective diffusion constant that you have here is the actual value, which is certainly positive. But then, and that's key here, how the equilibria shift as you shift the mass. And that does not have to be positive, obviously. That can be positive and negative. So you have a mechanism here by which the diffusion constant in this equation becomes negative. All right, but let me continue. There is another term, dc dn squared c star plus dm dn squared m star times dxn squared. All right. And some of you may know this structure. This is, if you like, a KPC equation or KS equation. It just is not it is not quite it, because this term here actually has a very strange dispersion, as you will see in a second. All right, so let's focus here on the diffusion term. So there's an effective diffusion term. And let's forget the nonlinearity, as I can read off the linear instability simply from looking at the diffusion term, the linear term alone. So when is that unstable? Well, it's clear it's unstable if the prefactor is negative. So the prefactor is negative means that dc dn c star plus dm dn m star is less than zero. And then what you have is a mass redistribution instability. And that's the mechanism by which you drive the system out of the homogeneous steady state. It's because there is a instability towards redistribution of the protein mass. And now let me rewrite that in a form so you see what this really means. So I can write this as dn c star over dn m star is less than minus dm over dc. And that is a really central and important geometric equation, again, for the process of pattern formation here. Namely, this here is again just the slope of the Nalkline. So this is the Nalkline slope. And I'm again comparing the Nalkline slope with another characteristic feature in my phase space. Now, it's not the slope of the simplex, but it's slope of the flux balance subspace. All right? So that means if the slope of the Nalkline is steeper than the slope of the flux balance subspace, you will have an instability. All right? And let's get this from this picture here. It's quite easy to get, actually. So here is the slope of the flux balance subspace. You now construct these lines, which are parallel to it. And you see the whole region of the Nalkline, which is in between this point and that point. So this whole regime here is unstable to redistribution of protein mass. So here you have a mass redistribution instability, and that here is the condition for the mass redistribution instability. All right. So without going through, and that's important for me here, a linear stability analysis, you can again just geometrically figure out what's going on in the phase space. You can also do a linear stability analysis, of course, and you get the same kind of condition. But what you don't find in the linear stability analysis, at least it's not obvious by looking at the analysis, is that there is this simple geometric intuition about it, and that the basic physical mechanism driving the instability is that redistribution of mass. Now, coming back to the question of Jean-François about the timescale separation, because if I'm doing that, he's right in saying this is not exact. And why should I believe this formula if it's not exact? It's only exact if the diffusion here is slow compared to the reactions, right? So that means the instability that you have needs to be one at long wavelength. So a Q going to zero instability, And then, if that's the case, then this condition is right. Okay, so let me show you that without going through the mass. Now the linear stability analysis, so let me call this LSA, is just an analysis where you look at deviations of the concentrations on the membrane and in the cytosol from the original homogeneous distribution, right? That's what you look at. And then you expand that these are the Fourier modes. And these Fourier modes then have a dispersion relation, sigma q. So meaning the Fourier modes, delta mq, will have a behavior such that you have a exponential dependence on the corresponding eigenvalues of this linear stability analysis. And this is some, tedious calculation, but not very complicated, which then gives you the eigenvalues as a function of wave vector. And there's two branches. There's one branch, which is like so. And this is the case for that particular point here, which I drew, which is locally stable. Right, so locally stable means that the eigenvalue here, so sigma local, is less than zero, and the branch emerging from that eigenvalue remains negative. So that's the branch which has an eigenvector that's roughly pointing along the reactive phase space. There's another eigenvector in the limit q going to zero that's pointing along the null cline. And this eigenvector has an eigenvalue zero, obviously, right? Because as you go along the null cline, you go along a set of equilibria, so nothing drives you back. You just go there, you stay there, you go further, you go further. So that means at q equals zero, this needs to be zero. And then there's this band of unstable modes, and this band of unstable modes has a maximum value, q maximum squared, which is given by this relation fm dc minus fc dm over dm dc. And now you say, well, if q max is positive, then you have a band of unstable modes. If it is negative, you don't. And as you see from the formula, that gives you exactly the same condition as the one that you have here. All right? And the question of Jean-François, well, here you have a long wavelength instability, and that's why at onset, this theory is actually asymptotically correct, and that condition is as well. The upshot is, as I said, that you get a condition telling you what the origin is of the instability. So let me summarize and let me take as a summary this picture here because it kind of says it all. So you can understand pattern formation in this simple model on the basis of a phase space analysis, staying in phase space. You have a set of landmark points and you have a set of geometric objects that guide the process. The geometric objects that guide the process are the null cline and the flux balance subspace. And the landmark points are this point, that point, and this point. They determine the plateau value and the intersection value. And the conditions you have on whether you have stability and instability are just conditions on whether the Nachlein slope is steeper or less steep than two other lines in this graph. If the Nachlein slope is less steep than the reactive phase space flow, then you have a stable local fixed point. If the Nachlein slope is steeper than the flux balance subspace, you do have a lateral instability. And now to close, there is still a region left which I didn't talk about yet, which I will talk about tomorrow, namely the region which you have that corresponds to this part and that part, right? So here in between that region and that region, so if I plot this here in terms of my masses, so for masses, protein masses in this band, you will have a local instability driving you towards a pattern, but patterns exist really in this range between the two intersection points of the flux balance subspace and the Nachlein. So what's going on here? Here I don't have a lateral instability, but I do have a pattern. So that means, and I take this as a preview to tomorrow, that the system there is excitable. And in a way, this is very similar to first order phase separation kinetics. There's a regime of a spinodal and a binodal, where in one case you have spontaneous pattern formation because you have a band of unstable modes, and in the other regime you need a final nucleus in order to trigger the system off to go into a patterned state. So with that, I close and thank you for your attention.